for the Human Brain Project. And today I would, of course, add on this, but going a little bit more specific into technologies, review at first what are our applications and what they might require, and then go into some technology trends. I must apologize, I cannot be very exhaustive in the shortness of the time that I have. I will present some scaling laws and ideas how technology will develop, go into the question of how to increase performances on all, let's say, fields. So this is computing, this is memory and memory bandwidths, and of course increasing it by more parallelism and discussing concurrency levels, discussing some memory developments, going into unconventional architectures where I believe we have a good chance to achieve the goals that we want to achieve in simulation and analytics, and maybe comment on the technology development that we go at this time in the Human Brain Project in the ramp-up phase, and maybe comment also what will come, give an outlook. So, so my let's say theorems I start with is that first of all the simulations of the human brain at scale, so full-scale simulations or large simulations, will require supercomputers approaching the exascale dimension, both in compute capability and of course also in the memory capability. There it will be suddenly hundreds or hundreds of petabytes to be available for that. On the other hand, going for analytics, and here I have the example of the imaging of the full brain, resolving then the single neurons and go to the sub-micrometer level, this will be constrained by the progress of data processing systems. It is very much related, but it is of course also different, and we have to discuss this. So yesterday I spoke of our code design projects. They exactly are intended in some part of their activities to address those questions, so to help to build up the supercomputers. And you see the keywords NEST coming up again, the NEST code for simulation of the mouse brain, NEST code also using in the human brain, then neuron for mouse-based cellular, cortical and subcortical microcircuit models, then the ATLAS, structure, connectivity and function, and visual motor integration in the human brain, again, let's say, matching top-down with bottom-up, top-down theories and ideas with bottom-up simulation and robotics. So this will give us the constraints and the requirements of the applications. And let's start with some discussion on applications. So the neural network simulations with NES and Neuron have as main feature that they involve a very high level of concurrency. High level of concurrency means huge parallelism, but you should also know they involve different levels of parallelism. I would call it different levels of concurrency, and it is not yet known how to utilize computers if you have programs with different level of concurrency. In fact, all larger programs expose different levels of concurrency, but this is something that is only, let's say, taken into account on the node level or on the processor level, but not on the level of, let's say, different technologies. Today you have different types of processors. You have multi-core, you have many-core, and different directions of those processors. And I will show you in this short talk that we also want to address this issue, which has not yet been addressed at all, only rudimentary using the CPU-GPU paradigm, where you have accelerating type of applications, but you do not use today the accelerators as let's say a sort of parallel repository, maybe for a bunch of CPUs to be useful to carry out highly scalable parts of the code. So we have a very large memory footprint as well, and this is important. Memory seems to become one of the very limiting factors. It's expensive if it is high bandwidth. They have lower arithmetic intensities. It's not completely true. The NEST has lower one, the neuron has higher one, and the more detailed the knowledge about the neuron becomes, and the more detailed physiology and other data are, the more compute intensive the models might become. In so far, I would say this low is only with a grain of salt. And we have global communication patterns, so we cannot really go for localization of both data and communication. That's an important issue here. Architectural challenges, we have to provide suitable models of parallelisms in order to define those architectures. This holds for the node level, this holds for the aggregation of nodes. We have to provide both high memory capacity and bandwidth with minimal hierarchization. Minimal means, in a sense, that it's also a question where we do the hierarchies on which level. And of course, optimize the communication. It's a less good fit, what I have sketched now, to current roadmaps of technology providers. That's an important issue. Current roadmaps of technology providers go, let's say, for a combination of CPU, GPU, Xeon Phi type processors, or ARM type processors will come. So it's not clear at this stage how this will really fit, and we have to do a lot in order to bring in our issues. And one of those is the interactive supercomputing. It has requirements. So it is data intensive. Interactivity and steering should be in analysis and visualization on the fly. And given the high amount of local memory, moving of data is just a cost, a power factor. So moving data means investing a lot of energy, and we have to avoid it at any means. So the mode of operation is probably also changing. It will be users running multiple jobs concurrently in a single session, large-scale simulation jobs together with data analysis jobs together with visualization pipelines, maybe on the same or on different type of computers, but that are connected, as well as a dynamic change of the required resources. So it can be that you at a certain path of the job, you will change resources within and those resources available to the session. So this will be a significant change of the operational model. So again, a challenge we don't meet yet. Technical aspects, of course, we have to increase the memory footprint. We need a huge memory space. First of all, to enable also checkpoint restart type of mechanisms. But also in order to do the huge, to cope with the huge memory requirements at all that we have. Maybe new non-volatile memory, NVM memory technologies will help. This is our great hope, so that we can, let's say, boost the memory footprint per core by a factor of 10 to 50, which will be required for the full brain simulation. So at this time, it does just not match to the technology roadmap. Scalable visualization, the same problem. It's constrained by lacking the ability to move all data. So we will not move, we will only move the visualization data out of the machine. And dynamical resource management has to be developed. If we go to the imaging problem, let's take again the imaging of the for the brain atlas. Here the main feature is, of course, a high level of concurrency, but a sort of less a difficult one where you have, of course, to exchange data at some stages of the process, but many of those processes can be done in, let's not call it trivial parallelism, but in parallelism. And again, you have architectural challenges. Efficient concurrent update of shared data structure is, and this is again, of course, connected to communication, is one of the problem. We don't have yet an efficient accelerator to accelerator communication. I come to this with my proposal. Again, and the management of petascale data volumes is required. If you look at what data volumes can be managed in current largest supercomputing centers or computer centers, I don't think that projects that reach up to 5 petascale are easy. They would nearly require all the resources such centers have available. This means also here we have to really find ways to work with those requirements, but we have a good fit to the current technology. We knew how to do it, but it's it comes with a cost, and we have made sort of extrapolation. We think that the computing cost and the data management cost will dominate everything in this field if one wants to go down to the micrometer level. What are technology trends? Let me present some. The scaling laws, of course, a well-known Moore's law. There it came from a cost estimate Moore did in 1965, where the evolution, the time evolution of optimal manufacturing costs for integrated circuits results in an exponential increase of the number of components per circuit. Finally, so on the left side you have those development of cost and the sweet spot, as you see, at a minimum. And then there comes a line where you see how it has developed. In recent years, it went down a little bit. We know it is stalled. There is a reason for that, and it can best be understood by Dennard scaling. Dennard scaling is also has also been found early by Mr. Dennard in, I think it was 74 or so, where the idea is one can change some parameters given a constant power with increasing or decreasing length of the gates. So one thing you can do is to increase the transistor density. This corresponds to Moore's law. Another one is to increase the clock frequency. We know that there was a breaking down, so the standard scaling is not followed anymore. And you reduce the supply voltage. So you can play with all of this. And what comes out of that is that the trend goes, now it does not appear, towards having more processors on one die. And this is, we will have an increase of, let's say, cores, and have seen already an increase of cores on the system. Another technology trend is expressed by Rentz rule. There is a question of, you have a number of logical elements, a number of edge connections, and Rentz coefficient. It results in a strategy because it will become difficult to balance the communication and the computation. We come again back to this later. So the trend is that you compute much more than you probably need for some problems. So those that require a very high memory rate are increasingly neglected, and that's interesting for all fields of science, especially for physics and chemistry, where we believe that the current trend is completely contrary to what we would need, namely very high memory rates and at a given, let's say, high rate of computation. So one potential strategy is a better memory hierarchy, to have very large memory on the one hand, maybe through non-volatile type of memory, to network memory on the network. But essentially, this is a very difficult field of research, and we'll also touch this in one of the next slides. Concurrency itself, we have different level of parallelism. We have core level, we have an instruction level parallelism. Each core can, at each of the clock cycles, execute multiple instructions concurrently, as you know. We have data parallel instructions, SIMD instructions, or vector units, however you call it, on those Intel and other chips. We have simultaneous multi-threading, so that you can have different sets of instructions executed in a simultaneous manner. On the processor level, we have multiple cores, we have many cores. This is an issue that's interesting. If we would have proper multi-cores, and if we would have proper many cores, which we don't have, in my opinion, which are not provided through the vendors, then we could really play with using those in the different level of concurrency. On the node level, we have multiple sockets, we have multiple accelerators. This is a sort of question of economy, maybe also of how to organize the communication on the system. On the system level, we have many nodes, but why don't we have many systems? This means, as I said before, why don't we have systems where you have, let's say, highly evolved vector cores, or like, for instance, provided by NEC, then other multi-cores like by Intel, and on top of that, two different variants of cores, those Xeon Phi cores or the NVIDIA type of cores in separate systems that can, of course, interact through these highly evolved networks. And I think that's one potential important way to go to solve the exascale problem that we really have. On the device level, you see that more and more flops can be carried out. Especially this is another hint that there is a problem, because not in the same manner the data rates go into the devices as flops they can carry out. And a very high level of parallelism you have on such systems, sometimes if you have problems that, let's say for molecular dynamics, where you have not infinite amount of degrees of freedom to compute, of course you are restricted to a small part of the system, and it is not used at all to have a parallel machine. Maybe you would then better buy an Anton system by Shaw or so. All this is somewhat neglected by industry, because industry is not at all interested in science. They want to make money through selling systems, and sometimes it fits with our scientific needs. So we have to do something here. Memory. The memory question is all important, as I said before. We have the capacity-driven technologies, the DRAMs, density scales according to roughly according to Moore's law. We have a very moderate and no increase of bandwidth. We only can increase bandwidth through parallelism again, which is limited because this is very costly. And you see the memory rates of current processor types. If you go to bandwidth-driven technology where you want to be faster, again, of course, it's limited. It limits the capacity by the costs. So to in future to exploit this, we have to go to, let's say, from two-dimensional to three-dimensional stacking technologies, maybe even including processing memory technologies. Again, you have some numbers here. They are not much larger than the numbers before. So here we are better, but we're still limited, and especially we are limited by a factor of 10 in capacity. Non-volatile memory. This is a third kind of course, you have all have it all in your pocket with your memory sticks, but they are more highly evolved ones. They have a significant higher density, but of course their bandwidth is very low. They are packaged as these I/O devices, as I said before. There might be a possible replacement of DRAMs. We have to find out. I will just present one example. There are several ones. In lack of time, I cannot go into detail here. But you see, there are different levels of memory, and the question is how, let's say, new unconventional future architectures of computers could be, let's say, brought up with those type of memories. So if you make again a sort of model looking at the question what is the capacity and what is the bandwidth of memory, so you see these high bandwidth memories have a low capacity. The DRAM memories have a higher ones, and of course the non-volatile ones that can be network attached in the future might be a very high one, but it is a reverse with the bandwidth. And if we then build a ratio of both, it is not a constant, that, thanks God, it's different orders of those ratios. And this is actually the guiding parameter to bring together a balanced system. So you see that you have for the high bandwidth memory, this ratio is 0.01. For the DRAM, and this is made in this manner, it's 1. And for the non-volatile one, it's 100. And the question is how those numbers in a given code can be, let's say, composed to give an optimal type of performance. And this is a challenge for the programmer, how to improve the data locality, how to manage the data transport. Of course, it's not only the programmer, the architecture, or the overall architecture has to be formed in this manner. And one of those unconventional architectures is if we focus on the processor, is processing in memory technology realized by the IBM Active Memory Cube. Here we can avoid data movement at all just by having the compute layer below or on top, whatever, however you see it, of the 3D memory stacking. And then, of course, you would have a very high memory rate. Certainly, such technologies will be one part of the future solution that we will see. If it is realized as fast as we believe, we have lots of experience. Just one of our people got a prize for evaluating this. This remains to be seen, but I'm very, let's say, optimistic that such type of technology node on node will solve part of the problems of given such a hierarchy solution. Another one we pursue in our lab, or in my lab, this is the so-called DEEP projects, again an EU-funded project altogether. This is, I think, 30 to 35 million euro funding. It focuses on concurrency and hierarchical memory. So the idea is to match some application scalability patterns that we have in, for instance, also Neuron is one part of our test programs, match those hardware characteristics with these application characteristics and exploit benefits of processor heterogeneity. So you have the many-core and you have the multi-core processors, that's the idea. We want to profit from the new memory technologies and so network-attached memory on a special network that can handle network-attached memory. This is the other question. You don't want to have a special node to do that. You want to have the network just plugged in, the memory just plugged in into the network, and the network itself is intelligent enough to handle the memory. That's the idea in an overall efficient loop, energy envelope. So what you see here is a sketch of how such a system looks. It is, of course, separated in order to give you an idea. You would have a cluster system on the left hand with cluster nodes, and you would have something that, again, is a cluster system, but to distinguish it, we call it a booster system, and with a very regular memory. A simple machine, maybe something like the connection machine of the 1990s, or something like you had with early parallel computers. It's not SIMD, it is, of course, absolutely MIMD, but it has networks that allow for very fast and much cheaper communication, and many core, in this case it's Xeon Phi, it will can finally have any type of many core. The major point is that this system will certainly be able, so you see what we have today, will be able to operate, let's say, attributing resources in a dynamical manner. So if on the left-hand side the cluster nodes are, let's say, 100 cluster nodes are assigned for a program, they can choose on the right-hand side what they need. And MPI process is spawned over the whole system. This will go on in order to encompass, and you can see it here as a sketch, to encompass the idea of network-attached memory, so that we have non-volatile network-attached memory also available on both sides in different, let's say, manners, so directly on the node or off the node. And of course, then you need a way to access those memory, maybe in such a way that you would not even know that it is on the network. That's the idea, the final one. And in order to realize this, you need a programming environment that can spawn those MPI processes as well as can manage the associated network attached memory question. So you see, we go more and more into virtualization of systems. This also was, in some sense, asked in my keynote from yesterday. I think that technologies, when developed for such type of system, finally will also help to really realize virtual supercomputing, high performance computing as a service, like we do today, maybe with a single node or with farming type of applications. So that is one of those unconventional architectures where I believe that those codes that we have in the Human Brain Project really will profit from in one or the other way. I have shown it in two compartments. Of course, such type of technology might also be realizable within one system. Just for the benefit of explanation here, I've done this. Just one last word of this talk onto the question of what do all the activities that we do in the Human Brain Project, how do they touch these issues? We do pre-commercial procurement, and again, the same questions that I have asked so far are asked to companies. They know the patterns of let's say, requirements that we have in the Human Brain Project running on pre-exascale, to be run on pre-exascale HPC platforms, and of course of our mode of operation. We want to procure those R&D services for this from companies, and for that we gave them technical goals, dense memory integration, integration of visualization, dynamic resource management. So this is part of the questions I have asked. There is a timeline of this PCP process, and we are already now entering phase three. So you see, we had five applicants. We have chosen from those five, not we, our international panel has chosen three of them. Then our international panel has chosen two finalists. They will both provide prototypes. These prototypes will already give us much more information on the future of technology than we had so far. So this will be finished within the ramp-up phase of the Human Brain Project. And if it is successful, and partly I already know today it is, it will certainly define the final procurement of a first stage of a computer for the Human Brain Project, that we have a good chance to be funded separately by the European Union. So the status is, as I said, we have a good response to the technological goals. We are just in this phase. Summary. The technology trends go towards increasing parallelism and deeper memory hierarchies. This is, sounds like a triviality, but this means something because we are already at a very, very high parallelism. If we talk about 500,000 cores, for instance, on our blue gene Q, what we think this road, the simple roadmaps of the companies quite well fit with data analytics. But the costs of data analytics will be dominated by computing for sure if you go to very low resolution, high resolution. We need better and faster hierarchical memory concepts and data locality for the simulations. That's very clear. So what the vendors offer us is by far not enough. New, let's say, memory technologies like computing in memory with the HMC of IBM and other technologies like I call cluster booster technologies are very promising. So the booster can easily scale to exascale. Clusters today cannot. These are the heavyweight computers. They cannot scale in the next 20 years, as you can foresee that. And I guess it is more the other way around today that supercomputing and data analytics as fields, as such, as technology, profit certainly from the guidance by neuroscience. Thank you.
Okay, we've got time for one or two questions. No? Oh.
Thomas, I just ask you about the interaction with industry that you described. Is that something you expect will be iterative over the life of the HPP, for example? Do you see that this is going to produce the technologies that are more
at least part of it. Yeah. At least it allows us to, and we have seed already to steer companies. I can name two of them, for instance, Cray, for instance, or IBM, to really look at their roadmap. And I think already this small project I'm talking about has changed the roadmap a little bit towards what is our need. Yeah? But it is not only within the Human Brain Project. So the idea to, let's say, to support or to really interest other supercomputer centers and technology users to help develop systems, this is really shaping the whole field. And that's the reason why I said, finally, the technology development profits a lot from the application field like the neuroscience. That was one of my motivations really to go into this field, because I can foresee going down to 1 micrometer, for instance, with imaging questions, or to simulate on a level of, I don't know, 500 petabytes of degrees of freedom that you need for the full brain, that this is something that is unprecedented, and I don't see it as necessary in most other fields. I would not know one field, except maybe the particle physics, they always can go very high up, or climatology at a very low resolution, but it's unclear to me at this time. Because many of those inverse problems would not profit from going to more resolution, because the unknowns that they have in order to determine them are so high.
Okay, would you like to join with me and we'll thank Thomas again for his talk?
Thank you.
It's my pleasure to introduce